Paris, and this is Lanada by Claire Voisin. And she will give us a talk on left standard conjecture for Lagrange at covered hypercalor varieties.
Okay.
So I start with
Yeah? Any problem?
Do you hear me?
Okay.
So I start with a statement of the hard Lefschetz conjecture.
Claire, if you're sharing something.
Oh, sorry, hard Lefschetz standard conjecture. So X will be a smooth projective.
I'm sorry, Claire. What are you using? Are you sharing something or are you using Blackboard?
Because you cannot see.
We don't see. If you share, we don't see it.
I am using the blackboard.
Dima, you can just click on the right.
You don't see.
No, it's fine. We can do it here. It's fine.
It makes sense to click and say pin video.
Yes. I know.
Who is not okay? I think you should see me now.
All right. Perfect.
So I start with a statement of the Lefschetz standard conjecture for smooth projective varieties over C, of course. And, so I assume that the dimension of X is n, and there is one statement like that for each degree. So maybe. It says the following, so I choose the polarization on X, so it will be the first chain class of a non-pole line model. And then you have the hard Lefschetz isomorphism in a degree K. So it's an isomorphism of a K product with the class Hx to the n minus k, and the hard Lefschetz isomorphism says that this gives an isomorphism between the cohomology of degree k and the cohomology of degree 2n minus k of x. So here I have to assume that k is greater than n, and so we have this isomorphism, which is an isomorphism of Hodge structures, and the Lefschetz standard conjecture for degree k is the following. There exists a cycle z, the codimension k cycle, with a q coefficient, such that if you consider the action of this cycle on cohomology of X. Now you look at it on so that will produce something like that. This action is the inverse of the Lefschetz isomorphism. So this is the statement. There are several ways of formulating it, but this is a statement that I consider. Of course, it is implied. So it's a remark that, it is implied by the Hodge conjecture on X cross X. And the reason is that, you see, this is an isomorphism of Hodge structure, so the inverse here is also an isomorphism of Hodge structure. And so, you play with a Cunette decomposition, there exists cause. There exists a Hodge class, which will be in a Hodge class of degree 2k. On X cross X, which induces such that the alpha upper star is exactly this. This is a very standard formalism. When you have a morphism of a Hodge structure, you have an endomorphism of the Hodge structures on X that produces for you a Hodge class on X cross X. And the question then is to realize this this alpha as the cohomology class of a cycle on X cross X. So, but in fact, it's very important to formulate, and it was of course known to Dick, but it is very important to formulate this conjecture independently of the Hodge conjecture, because it has a lot to say on the Hodge conjecture itself.
I'm sorry, can I ask you something very naive and stupid? Yeah. Claire, is it an independent statement for each key, or do you expect triple?
The Lefschetz standard conjecture has many consequences on the Hodge conjecture. And the classical conjecture that, that of course, will be addressed in the paper by, which is written up in the paper by Kleiman in the 70s, on the standard conjecture. The first implication is the following. Theorem, if X satisfies the Lefschetz standard conjecture, so you need only an even degrees, then what I will call H2K of XQ, Alge, and H2N minus 2K of XQ, Alge, are dual to each other. What I call H2K of XQ Alge, by definition, this is the set of algebraic classes, classes of algebraic cycles. Of codimension K. So you consider algebraic classes of algebraic cycles of codimension k and classes of algebraic cycles of codimension n minus k, and you look at the pairing, the Poincaré pairing between these two species, and the statement says that under this conjecture, this pairing is perfect. The implication is not totally easy, but the point is that if you you need to know about the Lefschetz decomposition associated to the hard Lefschetz theorem. So to construct the Lefschetz decomposition of cohomology using the starting from the hard Lefschetz isomorphism, you just need to invert the Lefschetz isomorphism in various degrees. So now, if you are able to, if you have these cycles, Z for each K, which inverts the Hodge-Lefschetz isomorphism, you conclude that these species, they will be stable under the Lefschetz decomposition. Once you have this, proving that that they are dual is just by applications of the Roger Riemann, Roger Riemann, second Roger Riemann relations. So there is this, this implication. Sometimes people say that summarizes this statement, saying that homological equivalence. Is of course it's a Q homological equivalence is the same as a numerical equivalence. Okay, so this is an example of a consequence. And so let me give more serious applications to the Hodge conjecture using this. So, an example of a consequence using that statement is the following. Suppose that you have an inclusion of a smooth, smooth projective, both satisfying the Lefschetz standard conjecture. Let Z be a cycle on Y. And assume that this Q coefficient, and assume that its cohomology class Z comes from a cohomology class on X. Hodge class here, it's an algebraic class. So I am in this situation, and then the conclusion is then there exists a cycle Z prime. X such that the class Z is G for star Z prime. This is a kind of statement. Here I just make the assumption that I have a cycle. I just make the assumption that it's a topological assumption that its cohomology class comes from a cohomology class of X. And then using that Lefschetz standard conjecture, I conclude that the cohomology class can be extended to X as an algebraic class. And in fact, the implication from here to here is totally formal. It's just playing with duality. So,
Claire.
That gives an idea of what is the power of this conjecture. And another application, which is very important in my mind, which directly uses this, is the following theorem. So I'm not sure about what is the attribution. Maybe it's some paper of Yves André, or I don't know exactly if it is due to nobody, it is due to myself. I don't know exactly who wrote this first. This is the following result. So, that the Lefschetz standard conjecture implies the variational Hodge conjecture. So the variational Hodge conjecture ces offerings, so suppose that you have a smooth projectivity. You have a cycle Z of codimension K on Y with a Hodger class. So this is a cycle class of Z. And now you put your Y in a family. Here the P is smooth projective with central fiber Y. So let's assume that the B is a ball for simplicity. And you assume that the class, you transport this cohomology class alpha near fibers, so alpha T, well, all the fibers are homeomorphic to the central fiber. So you have the class alpha T, which is in alpha in H2K of YT Q. And the assumption is that it remains a Hodge class on YT. And the statement of the variational Hodge conjecture in that case is that this class alpha t is still algebraic. It was algebraic by assumption on the central fiber, and it remains algebraic. I am not saying that the ZT are for the family with the Z. I am not saying that it's not true in practice that the Z deforms to ZT. I am just saying that there exists a cycle ZT. On the fiber white. And
Claire.
Well, maybe just
Claire. Can I ask a question?
It's not a formal consequence of what has been written before. The key point is of course the key ingredient is the catani de ligne Kaplan theorem, which says that the Hodge loci are algebraic. That is the fact that the Hodge loci are algebraic. So the Hodge loci, typically, the situation like this, it will be the locus of points where the class, certain Hodge class remains Hodge. So the fact that the Hodge loci are algebraic, that says that this local situation it is always a piece inside a global algebraic situation. So that means that in practice, I can assume that in fact, this local data comes from a global situation where this script Y is also a smooth projective variety. And then the second ingredient is the line invariant cycle theorem that will guarantee that this class alpha t that we have will exist on the wall of Y. So then I am now in that situation because I have my class alpha, it's alpha zero, and then if I use these ingredients to globalize the situation, I will have a class alpha on the wall of here the Y will be smooth projective, and there will be an alpha extending the alpha zero. And then we can apply this, and the fact that here the plus alpha zero is algebraic, we say that we can choose alpha to be algebraic. And, this is a very so this is to give an idea of how this conjecture is important. And so now I want to discuss examples. And so there are not so many examples where we know how to prove the Lifshitz standard conjecture. The main result. So the main known case, of course, is the case of abelian varieties, which is due to Lieberman. All the classical result, but in that case, the Lifshitz standard conjecture is quite easy because suppose that you have A, which is an abelian variety. Then you can choose a Poincaré divisor. Well, you choose a polarization, which A, and you can construct a Poincaré divisor, say D, on A cross A. So this is a divisor which has the property that it induces the isogeny between A and the dual, which is the peak zero of A. And the Poincaré divisor, well, of course, if I choose it, if I choose conveniently the H A, will exactly satisfy the property that D upper star the dimension of A is N. Is an isomorphism between D upper star composed with the cup product map of the Lifshitz isomorphism. Is the identity. So, if you like, the Poincaré divisor, it exactly, exactly solves the Lifshitz standard conjecture in degree one. And then you're using the fact that HK of A is HK H1 of A, you easily conclude when it's a computation that if you consider now your D intersected K tags with itself, now it will be not, so the D was in CH1 of A cross A, and the D to the K will be in CHK of A cross A. And you can see that easily that if you look at the DK star composed with a cup product with HK to the minus K from HK of AQ to HK of AQ, that will be a multiple of the identity. So in fact, in the case of just the theory of the quaternary divisor, solves in fact the Lefschetz standard conjecture and all degrees. And so now I want to turn to the case of hyperkähler manifold.
Just checking. So.
So, well, these varieties. So I will contain only projective hyperkähler manifolds. So they are all of even dimension. And one property is that we know that each I zero of x is zero for I odd, and H 2i 0 of x is generated by the holomorphic two form on x, or H 2 0 of x is generated by one holomorphic two form, which is everywhere non-degenerate. And so in that case, if you, of course, the first case was Lefschetz standard conjecture is interesting, is the case of degree 2. This is equivalent to saying that well, the Lefschetz standard conjecture in degree 2 is equivalent to the following fact: there exists a surface sigma such that gamma in CH2 of x cross sigma such that gamma per star maps surjectively so would you just need the correspondence to a surface, zero correspondence to a surface such that all the two zero forms on X are come from two zero form on sigma. So this equivalence is due to the paper of Charles and the thesis. It's not very hard, and it's also equivalent to the fact that there exists a Z
there,
H2 of x cross x, such that Z per star of hx 2n minus 2 sigma x is equal to sigma x. But I want to say that you just need to maybe call it Z lef. You just need to check the defining property of a Lefschetz correspondence on the two zero part. The reason is that the H2 of X is the direction of it's a transcendental part and the Néron Severi group, tensor Q. I suppose that you have this equality satisfied on sigma x. It will be satisfied. On the rule of H2 of XQ TR, the reason being that here you have a morphism of non-homomorphism of Hodge structures from H2 of X to H2 of X. Now we know that the Hodge structure on H2 of XQ TR is. It's a simple, but it does not contain any non-trivial Hodge substructure. The reason being that it's because the H2-0 is one-dimensional, so if you have a Hodge substructure, non-trivial Hodge substructure, it should be, cannot contain any H2-0 part. And so then if you have this property satisfied on sigma x, it is also satisfied on the whole transcendental Hodge cohomology. And then you can easily correct your Lefschetz cycle so that the relation also holds on the Néron Severi part, just by adding to the ZF decomposable. Okay, and now once you have this property satisfied, then at least that will say that for any, suppose that you have your Lefschetz cycle for degree 2 cohomology, so we will get that for any alpha in. So now I consider. The subalgebra of the cohomology of X, which is generated by H2, once you, exactly as in the case of abelian varieties, once you have the cycle ZLF for degree 2 cohomology, then you can consider this cycle. So maybe. I consider the Lefschetz cycle, which is of dimension 2, I put it to the power I, and I check that this one satisfies for some. Let's say this. So maybe, okay. Let me do it only for a moment. Only for the sigma x. X to the 2n minus this will be lambda I sigma x to the I. So what I want to say is that once you solve the Lefschetz standard conjecture in degree 2, then you solve the Lefschetz standard conjecture essentially for the cohomology which is generated by H2, which is not the whole cohomology of X, but this is a big part. In particular, it contains all the holomorphic forms. Okay, so what is known concretely? So So the main important result, main general result on the Lefschetz standard conjecture for hyperkähler manifold was proved by Charles and Markmann. The Lefschetz standard conjecture holds in any degree for a hyperkähler manifold, which is a projective deformation of a punctual Hilbert scheme of a Petri surface. Here I should mark that for Fn itself, the standard conjecture is the most trivial. Well, at least in the V2, the most higher degree of the something. Because you can use you have the incidence correspondence. Yes, this is a correspondence between the Hilbert scheme and the surface itself. So here it's a flat. So IN will give something of codimension 2 in the product SN cross N. So this is flat of degree N. And the IN upper star. Well known that it induces a surjective map. So for Sn itself, the Lefschetz standard conjecture is trivial, but here there is no real, of course, the Ketri surface does not deform when you take a general projective deformation of X. So you have to find another argument. They do indeed a deformation argument, but not it's not certainly not this correspondence that they will deform. What they will deform is they will use the Fabitsky the Fabitsky theory of hyper holomorphic bundles and the fact that it has a very good deformation property. Okay, so. Another thing that I wanted to mention is the fact that for many hyperkähler manifolds that we know, the Lefschetz standard conjecture in the Greto is obvious. When I say other examples, in fact, most of the examples that I will write here follow from the power of the deformation tape of the scheme. So we could also apply the Charles Markmann theorem, but not all. So the proposition. It's not even a proposition. The hyperkähler manifolds. So let me write a long list. Okay. F1 of Y. Okay. So this one. Is that enough? For Y smooth cubic four-fold. satisfy the Lifshitz standard conjecture at this integral 2. So this guarantee, so the F1 of Y, so the Bovin de Nagy. Sorry.
Can you hear us?
Yes.
Because you could hear us for last hour, I mean half hour. Something wrong with the headphones, I think.
Sorry?
There was some problem with the headphones, I think. So there were some questions, but you couldn't hear us. Can you hear us now?
Yes, now I hear you, yes. Yeah. But okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, this was perfect. This was
okay,
fine.
Okay.
Okay, we hope it works.
Okay. No, I'm sorry.
No, but we could hear you just fine, so we follow.
Okay. Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, perfect. So it's not perfect, but so do you have do you have questions?
Well, what's F1? It's final variety of lines, or?
Okay, so let me comment on this notation. So why is a smooth cubic four-fold? This is the variety of lines. Okay, so this is was constructed by Beauville and Donaghy and proved to be a hyperkähler four-fold. This is constructed from it's a base of the rationally connected so the MRC vibration of F3 of Y. So F3 of Y is the Hilbert scheme of rational cubic curve. So it was constructed by Lane Zorger van Straten. This one was constructed by Lazar, Saka, and myself. And it is constructed as it's a compactification. Of the intermediate Jacobian vibration. Something like that. That is, you consider the family of hyperplane smooth hyperplane section, which is parametrized by U containing P5 dual. So it parametrizes a smooth cubic three-folds containing Y. Each one has an intermediate Jacobian, which is a five-dimensional complex torus. So that makes a ten-dimensional manifold, which is Lagrangian fibered over an open set. And we constructed a hyperkähler compactification for this intermediate Jacobian vibration.
The deformations of Hilbert schemes, or are they all deformations of Hilbert schemes?
Oh no, precisely. This one, yes, it was due to Beauville and Donaghy. This one also, this was proved by. For this one, it was proved, I think, in the same paper, or maybe another one by Dicton. I don't remember Dicton and Lin. I don't remember exactly. So this one is a deformation of S to the four. So it's eightfold of this one. This is a fourfold. So it deforms the S2. But this one, it is of O-graded tape. So it is a deformation of a hyperkähler manifold of O-graded tape.
But do you get the full family, or is it not the full family?
Which
is
here?
Yeah.
No, because if you consider a general projective deformation of a hyperkähler manifold, its Picard number is 1.
Ah, oh, there is one more.
Fix the polarization and the deformation theory. Mm-hmm. Here, because by definition, our hyperkähler manifold are Lagrangian fibered. That means that they have a row of 2. So it's not a complete family, it's because we keep the Lagrangian class. And the reason for this proposition, the fact that there exists a gamma in for all these examples. Ah yes, I should add. Sorry. And more generally, all the varieties constructed by this beautiful paper by Bayer. Bayer Laos, Macri, Stellare, Perry, Neuer. Okay. So they construct hyperplane manifolds from the moduli species of associated to the set of components of general hyperplane, general cubic four-fold. And all of them will also satisfy this the Schmidt-Sandard conjecture in degree 2. And the reason is that for all these varieties, simply by the way they are constructed, they admit gamma, which is in the CH3 of X cross Y. Here it's the cubic four-fold.
Inducing such that the 2-0 form on X, the 2-0 class on X, is pulled back from the 3-1 class of on Y. Okay. And so we have this almost by definition or by construction, and. Now the point is that a cubic four-fold, the motif of a cubic four-fold, it's the same as the motif of a surface.
Plus some trivial parts, right?
It's a motif of a surface. But it is, you can construct a surface sigma. And the correspondence between y and sigma, this, so that the H20 of sigma subjects to the H21. And if you combine both, you get the Lechet standard conjecture for your x.
So these are examples. So now I come to my work.
Indeed, you are right. Of course, among these varieties, and in particular, all of them, there are deformations of deformation equivalent to a Hilbert scheme of Petri. So we could as well apply the Charles Markman recipe. For now, I discuss the case of Lagrangian fibers. Hyperkeller varieties, so there will be a projective one. So I want that there is a morphism. My x has dimension 2n, here the b has dimension n, and the fibers x, b are Lagrangian. For the 2-0 form sigma x. So it is known, so there is an associated class called the Lagrangian class. Okay, so it's an algebraic class, it's a non-severé group, which is defined as a pullback of the generator, positive generator. And well, this is known to be one-dimensional by work of Matsushita. What is known also by work of Matsushita is that deforming the X together with its Lagrangian fiber shell is the same as deforming X together with its this Hodge fast. So this is of course so rational of tape 1-1. So if you preserve L as a Hodge class, then you preserve the Lagrangian vibration. This is this now to Matsushita.
But
now there is a big conjecture on the existence of Lagrangian vibration. So, I call a conjecture SYZ. I'm not sure if Strominger, Yaoz, or so. I don't think the terminology is adapted. But let's write it like that. This is a characterization of hyperkilo manifolds admitting Lagrangian fibration, or rather, a characterization of the Lagrangian classes, associated to Lagrangian fibration. It says that if assume that X is projective, I suppose that N, so it's a class. Considering group tensor Q. Belongs to what I call the birational, what is called birational Keller cone, and to satisfy the Q of L equals zero, where Q is Bouville Bogomolov. This is a condition which is satisfied by the Lagrangian classes. Again, then L is associated. L comes from a Lagrangian fibration, maybe not not on X itself, but Lagrangian fibration on the X prime, which is birationally equivalent to X. So X prime is also hyperkeler and birational to X. What I call the birational Keller cone, you consider all the hyperkeler manifolds which are birationally equivalent to X. For each of them, you consider the Keller cone, and you consider it in the cohomology of X, and you take the union of all of them. Okay, so I have two results to present, which are the following. If X admits Lagrangian fibration, so X is a projective hyperkeler. Satisfies one of the two conditions. So So the condition one is a the fact that and the condition two, which is of course less this conjecture SYZ is really very hard, very central in the domain. So satisfying this conjecture is a big thing. But one should know that satisfying this conjecture SYZ, it's a deformation invariant property. This is due to the result of Matsushita concerning the fact that Lagrangian vibration deforms.
I'm sorry, Claire, can I ask?
The second case where it works is there exists a divisor. Effective divisor such that Q of theta is negative. Here the theta is the cohomology class of theta, and again the Q is a Bogomolov quadratic form on H. So this is the assumption, and the conclusion is that then X satisfies the Schetz standard conjecture in degree 2. Okay, so this is the first result.
Sorry,
the problem with this result is that it contains Lagrangian fiber the hypercular manifolds and when they are Lagrangian fiber, as we already said, so the Picard number is at least two because there will be a class of polarization plus the Lagrangian class, it's at least two. So now I want to mention a result which works for hyperkeller manifolds with Picard number one. So this is the Lagrangian fibered case. And now I'm going to speak on the Lagrangian covered case. Here, instead of having a Lagrangian fibration, I want to have something like that. So for the Lagrangian covered hyperkeller manifold, it's a hyperkeller manifold which is swept out by a family of Lagrangian subvarieties. So that will be represented by here L and B will be a smooth projective. So this is the phi will be the surjective. So here, the phi is a surjective, and what I want is that the phi restricted to the fibers LB is generically finite. Well, of course, for the general B. Is a generically infinite to its image. Which is Lagrangian.
It's the whole phi.
The Lagrangian, sorry, I'm forced to erase this. The Lagrangian covered varieties, well, they exist experimentally. There is a result explaining why they exist, and they exist even when the Picard number is equal to one, which is this one proposition. But if there exists zero containing X, which is a smooth Lagrangian subvariety, with globally generated normal bundle, then X is a Lagrangian covered. And the reason is simply the fact that an old result of me, which says that the deformation theory of Lagrangian subvarieties, smooth Lagrangian subvarieties, is inside a hyperkilo-manifold, is an obstructed. So when you have this this L0, this globally normal, globally generated normal bundle, the first order deformation extends to any order, that will provide a covering family like this. Okay. And, typically, an example where you meet this situation is if you take again the Bovill-Donaghy, so variety, which is the variety of lines in a smooth cubic four fold, it is Lagrangian covered. This situation, if you consider so the cubic is contained in the P5, now if you take a generic hyperplane, you will get the cubic threefold, the hyperplane section, which is smooth. And you consider the surface of lines in this this white edge. And it's very easy to see that this is the Lagrangian surface inside Y, and we are in this exactly in this situation. And of course, in a general case, rho of is equal to one from if Y is very general. Okay, conclusion is that this situation, this Lagrangian covered situation, quite a general situation. And the second result I want to explain is the following. Let X be hyperkeller four-fold with rho of X is equal to one. Then, if X is Lagrangian fibered, X satisfies the Lipschitz standard conjecture in degree 2. Okay, so maybe I'm so I hope to have a similar result for higher dimensional hyperkeller manifolds. But the assumptions are not really clear for the so let me explain the idea of proof. robust theorem. What was the theorem two? So, the point is that. So let me consider. This situation, which is more general than the Lagrangian vibration case, because in the Lagrangian vibration case, I just have a L equal to X. So the point is that the fibers are Abelian varieties, cheating a little is not true in that case, but there are Abelian varieties in the Lagrangian fiber case. It's not the general case, I mean, in the case of Lagrangian uncovered, there are not Abelian varieties, but still. You can construct D, so out of D in CH1 of L cross B N. Well, even if they are not Abelian varieties, you can do this. L containing B containing ALB LB. And consider the Poincaré divisor on ALB LB and restrict it to LB cross LB, restrict to LB cross LB. So by putting together the Poincaré divisors on the fibers, I can construct a D, which is in CH1 of the fiber product of L over B, such that what will do this
I'm sorry. Yeah, there was a little bit. So a question right to until I can. How bad are the fibers in general? First of all, is it true that the base is half dimensional or is it bigger?
I only know, a priori, no. The what I know that the
fibers. So here's a dimension 2A.
Here. The fiber is of dimension L, N, because they are Lagrangian varieties. And the dimension of the base will be at least N. In fact, I will reduce to the case where N is, because I know that the morphism is generically finite. On the fibers LB, I will, in fact, reduce just by taking a general complete intersection in D. Okay. I can always assume by restricting the situation that the dimension of the base is N. And in fact, in practice, I will do that.
Okay.
And because then I can pull back, then push forward.
And in the example of the Fano variety, what is this L then? It's not an Abelian surface, is it?
In the example in F1 of Y, the Lagrangian surfaces, they are of a general type, and they are the famous Fano surfaces, which have been very much studied. Their Albanese variety is five dimensional. It's the it's the Jacobian of the cubic trifold, so
okay.
So they have nothing to do with an Abelian variety, but it's not really a problem because the Poincaré divisor will exist on like this. The important fact is the fact that the morphism from LB to ALB LB is in fact it's finite to its image. It's because the normal bundle is generically globally generated. The cotangent bundle is also generically, globally generated, so you know that. Okay, so in any case, you on here you will have a DB which is constructed. So I should say that maybe I should start from an ample line bundle on X, like this, pull it back to L, and so the fibers will be polarized, and out of the polarization, I will construct a Poincaré divisor on the relative Albanese variety, and then by restriction, I will get the one I want here. Okay, and now the important. Okay, so. The important property of this. So this D, of course, it gives. Of course, so let's assume that the dimension of B is n. So of course, by this fiber product, it maps to the product L cross L, and I get a G lower star D, which I define to be gamma L, and this will be now in CH n plus one. Of L cross L. Okay. So here I restrict to this situation where the base has a dimension n. So if you prefer, that would be the L prime.
Claire, what is J? What is J?
J is the inclusion of the fiber product.
Ah, okay.
Here, if I assume that the dimension of B is the small n, so that B is in fact the B prime, if you like this, then this inclusion has codimension n, and so that push forward a codimension one cycle to a codimension n plus one cycle. Okay. And the crucial property in so in the Lagrangian fiber case. So maybe so in the Lagrangian what I get is that so now I am L is X and I am on X the cycle gamma. So maybe I will denote in that case by gamma p. So I have x. Okay. I have the following formula: that gamma p upper star of hx 2n minus 2 sigma x is l to the n minus 1 sigma x. Okay, so of course it's not finished. For the Lefschetz standard conjecture, I need cycles of codimension two, which when acting on this will give a non-zero to zero form. Here I just was just successful to producing this formula. And so now the trick. The trick is this, so let's assume that the rho of X is equal to 2, so the Néron-Séveré group will be generated by my ample class and an L. And here I will get a Q2 with the Bovill quadratic form, which is hyperbolic, so there is a second class in this rank 2 space with a hyperbolic quadratic form, such that Q of L prime is also zero. So I can assume that so Q of L prime HX is positive. And so now there are two possibilities. So if L prime is the Lagrangian class of a Lagrangian vibration, then I will have an X like this, associated with this L prime, and so I will have a gamma similarly constructed gamma P prime, and the Lefschetz. I recall that I want something of codimension 2 will be defined as so let's say gamma P prime. Let's see, maybe I put the transpose here, but in fact it is symmetric. So what does it do geometrically? So you see that you have your Lagrangian vibration. So the first cycle, gamma L, parameter divisors in the fibers of P. And now if you have now the second, so now it's the second vibration P prime. What will do this Z left, that over each divisor here it will put, so here for the gamma L prime of if you see this family of cycles of dimension n minus one in X parameterized by X, you will be given by divisors the fibers of P prime, and the Z left the codimension two cycles Z left X. So you start from an X which parameterizes a divisor in this fiber, and then you are going in the other fibers, and you will attach all the corresponding divisors in the other direction. So this is what is doing this this composition. This formula to both gamma P and gamma P prime, you find that gamma, so this Z left, which is composed, this composition like that. So we find the formula that we want, so it is proportional to maybe
okay. By the way, can I ask you?
So here there is a lambda, maybe a lambda prime. Yeah. Okay.
Is it true that the two vibrations are always transversal, or it's not necessary?
Well, you can show that generically the intersection is finite.
So that's correct.
Because if you consider the pair P, P prime, if you like, it's because Q of L, L prime, you know that it is non-zero.
Right, that's
so this implies that L to the N, L prime to the N, this intersection number is non-zero.
But what happens is if the other vibration is only biration, what happens if you need to change the birational model? Is it still working?
It works very, very well due to work of Weibrecht. In fact, when you have a birational equivalent model, there is a correspondence between X and the birational equivalent model X prime, which preserves everything.
Okay.
It preserves even the multiplicative Chow groups, for example.
Right. So
it preserves the quadratic Bovill-Bogomolov quadratic form. So in fact, it's you can really go to another model without any problem. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is the easy case when you have a second Lagrangian vibration. But there is another case which works very well, and that's why there are the two cases in my theorem. The second case is when the second class L prime, instead of being the Lagrangian class of a Lagrangian vibration, is when it is not in the birational Keller cone. Okay. And it turns out that these two cases will exhaust everything because you know, I had a case where I have an effective divisor theta with Q of theta negative. And by an easy computation that already appeared in a paper by Julia Sacca, this implies precisely that the L prime is not in the birational Keller code. And curiously, that case works very well because there is the following result, which is due to Ulrike Ries, but which builds very much on the works of Weybrecht. In that case, there exists R. So suppose that you have a projective hyperkeller manifold with the L prime, so that is satisfying so an element of the neuron Severi group, which satisfies Q of L prime.
Q of L prime is equal to zero. Maybe you have to assume that Q of L prime. You choose a positive generator. Then there exists a R, which is in the CH. So it's a self-correspondence of X, even not with Q coefficients. Such that it preserves everything, so a ring automorphism. And also, which preserves the Bovill-Bogomolov at the H2, and it preserves the Bovill-Bogomolov quadratic form, such that. If you consider R burst R of L prime, it belongs to the birational Keller code. So it's very nice to say that when you have an isotropic class, which is in the right part of the Keller code, maybe it is not in the back. Birational Keller cone, but you can put it in the birational Keller cone by letting a self-correspondence act. So this is this place. This really builds on a Weybrecht result about the birational tape of hyperkeller manifolds. And so that case works very well because suppose that L prime itself does not belong to the birational Keller cone, then I have this R, and I find that the R burst R of L prime, it cannot be L prime because L prime is not in the birational Keller cone, so it multiple of L. Well, there are only two isotropic cases, so that must be the L. But for the L, we know that there exists this Lagrangian fluctuation. And so in that situation, I can define gamma L prime, which will be the, by definition, that will be R minus 1 composed with gamma L or gamma P. And then I do exactly. So in that case, the second Lagrangian fluctuation does not exist, but I replace it formally by this. Then the Z left will be the gamma composed with and as you can see, logically, the two cases considered cover the two cases I had in the first.
Claire.
And the Lagrangian covert case, it's similar. In some sense, easier because I have the gamma n. And in the second case, essentially, I just iterate the gamma n. That's essentially the gamma n, wrong gamma n, which is going to has to explain. Why it works, but the key point is the fact that the Picard number is one. So maybe I don't want to say one more. Maybe I stop now.
Claire. Claire. It doesn't work again. Claire.
We're talking. Okay. It does work here.
You can write something in chat and she will see it.
Claire. Claire,
still can't hear us. Right?
I think you should write something in chat. At least she can read it.
I wrote many things, but she doesn't know what is happening.
Does it work now?
Костик, отключи одно из ее устройств. Просто отключи его нафиг.
Которое?
Саш, какое?
Окей.
You have two devices and one of them doesn't work.
Yes, I think
that. That's the problem. It kills off the other one. But now you can hear it. Right?
Yeah.
Good. So are there any questions? We can.
Can I ask, Claire?
Yes, of course.
In your formula for gamma L prime, you use R inverse.
Yeah. But
do you know that it is given by a correspondence?
Yes, I should have mentioned this. It's part of the theorem. There exists an R which has an it's more invertible. There exists also R minus one. In fact, these kind of correspondences, they are constructed as limits of automorphism, you know how to say. You know, there is this, this reason I work with, that if you have two birational equivalent hyperkegel manifolds, after taking a small deformation, XT and X prime by GT prime, they become isomorphic. So, so you can consider the graph of this isomorphism and go to the limit. And when you specialize, what you get is an effective cycle, which is well, the graph of a birational isomorphism plus some component. This is the kind of correspondences which appear.
Okay. Thanks. That's great.
More questions?
And maybe another question. Did you explain what you do in the case of Lagrangian covered space? If X is only covered by Lagrangians, not fibered?
Sorry, I didn't understand what is the. So in the case it is not, it is only covered. What are you asking?
Probably I missed. Did you explain what you do in this case? How you prove your theorems in this case?
No, I said I just said it's green. But it is still easier in that case. You have your N. Like this. So I restrict to the case where they are both the same dimension. So I have the gamma. So I have the gamma L prime, which was this G lower star of D. D was in CH1 of L prime cross B. And then I define, I push forward this gamma L prime to X. And what works in that case is just intersecting this, iterating this, so this one is in the n plus 1. In that case, I do gamma L prime X compose with itself. So, you see, in the case of the Lagrangian regression, that does not work because when you intersect the gamma P with itself, you get zero. This is due to the fact that there is this formula which says that the gamma pi is the star of hx when minus 2 sigma x. I have found that it is a lambda e to the n minus 1 sigma x. But the problem is that the intersection pairing on ln minus 1 of xq. This intersection pairing is trivial because the L is the Lagrangian class. But in the Lagrangian fiber case with rho of x equals 1, I will be able to prove this, of course, for the moment I know in that case. I can show that gamma upper star of so it's hx to sigma x. I can show it is equal to hx sigma x, or maybe there is a lambda. And the crucial point is that the self intersection of this is non zero. So that makes a big difference when you iterate. Your When you iterate the self-intersection of this divisor or formula like like this will play a role. If instead of this Hx, I have this L, unfortunately, I will get a sum over X of L squared in my X in my bar, and this is zero. That's why in the Lagrangian favor case, I needed the two classes. And at the end, when I did this, I'm trying to pose with gamma p. I use these two formulas. But because here the two formations are there, and what I find is that what is used to compute the result at the end is the fact that so that's why how at the end you can show that composing the two, you will get a non-trivial action on the Lefschetz operator on top of the cohomology. And in the Lagrangian covert case, the crucial point is to have this and to have this this formula instead.
Okay, thank you. And what about to which hyperkeller varieties you can apply these theorems? Does it apply to de Barvoisin or something?
De Barvoisin, first of all, the Charles-Lachmann theorem applies because it's there are deformations. Of S two. Also, you can apply a similar argument as for those varieties associated with the cubic fourfold, because, for example, for the Debar voisin, well, there are varieties like there are many Fano manifolds associated which have a very small motif, like the Peskin variety. Well, there are a number of varieties which have natural correspondences to the de Barvoisin variety, and which will replace the cubic fourfold. So you can also directly work with that. But let me remember. Yes, I think the de Barvoisin. Yes. So that will also apply because it has a covering by Lagrangian surfaces. Yeah.
And the reason you need to mention four in this our case is precisely because of this discretization in the middle, right? So why do you need to restrict four?
Sorry, I didn't understand the question.
Why do you need to restrict the dimension four?
It's so, when I establish this formula.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Right. It's this basic computation. Yeah.
Yes. In general, this construction is very naive. So suppose that I have constructed a gamma. It's a general situation. I will have a gamma L per star. Mapping inside H to n of x. There is an action on this. And there is a lemma that if you know how to compute to compose the correspondences and the action, if the intersection is a ring, so this is middle degree cohomology. restricted to the image of this is the degenerate. And for the then X satisfies the Vilches Comma conjecture in the degree 2. And this is because you are just going to put to consider the gamma L, you compose it with itself or with it transpose, and you check that using this, that this is different from zero, so this is not necessarily a non-zero multiple of the two zero form. But you have to check something. This, the condition that rho x is equal to 1 was exactly. That produced for me this formula. In higher dimension, I have to compute this. I know it's non-trivial, but the problem is to show the intersection that the image to put the right condition so that the image is the intersection pairing is non-zero, non-degenerate on the image. So that that's why in a higher dimension I think there will be geometric assumption, but it is not completely clear to me what the correct assumption has to be put.
And so maybe a naive question in this, can you, how should I put it? Is there any conjectural characterization of things which can be Lagrangian covered in terms of cohomology? Something like SYZ for Lagrangian covered?
Maybe all. I think that there was a, so as I explained, maybe did I explain this? The Lagrangian subvarieties deform quite well with Hyper-Kellogg manifold. And in particular, so I had a deformation result that says that if you have a Lagrangian submanifold, such that if you consider the restriction map from H2 of X to the H2 of the Lagrangian manifold as a rank only one, okay, so for example, it will be automatic if the bigger number is one, for example. Because then, because it's a Lagrangian to manifold, so all the transcendental cohomology will vanish on the Lagrangian to manifold. So if the picker number is one, this restriction map will have only rank. And then I prove that the Lagrangian subvariety remains stable under projective deformations of your X. So, and so this says that together with the results, saying that if you have a Lagrangian submanifold with globally normal, globally generated normal bundle, you have a Lagrangian covering. You get some evidence for the fact that it's not so exceptional to have such a Lagrangian covering.
Let me put the other way around. The other varieties which cannot be Lagrangian covered.
I mean, in the projective setting, in Hyper-Kellogg, you mean?
Yeah.
No, I think it's the conjectures is more that there exist Lagrangian varieties. And so I think that Grady had something about Lagrangian covering existing, a sort of conjecture of fantasy. That maybe the possibility that exists for many.
Right. So,
in fact, for example, I discussed last year in Moscow the notion of surface decomposition on a hyperkalian manifold. If a hyperkalian manifold is amidst a surface decomposition, it is Lagrangian covered. Because, on the product of surfaces, S1 cross Sn, if you take a product of curves, C1 cross Cn, that is a Lagrangian for any to zero form. And they will transport to Lagrangian varieties.
It's really for a generic situation in a sense. Yeah.
We don't know, but it will be.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Comments? So if not, I mean, let's thank Claire again for a wonderful talk. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, the problem with the sound.
No, the technical problem is that there are two devices and one doesn't have... Yeah.